Had to bring out my preaching towel. I ain't had to bring this thing out in a while. It's anointed, by the way. It's got all kind of oil on this thing. Probably needs to, I ain't washing it. Smells a little bit, though. So if you come hug me after this, I'm going to say it's the anointing oil. Woo! I told Micah, I said, I got it this morning. I said, I've been up since 4 o'clock and got more energy than I know what to do with. Oh, I have one other announcement. This is why I put stuff in my notes. There's a really, really cool event that's coming up this coming weekend at Lawrence Park. It's called Awesomeness. I don't know if you heard of it before or not, but it's what's the guy's name that puts it on, please? Gregory. Gregory puts this event on every year. He goes out and he feeds people in the park. It doesn't cost the people anything. They just are able to come out and they get a free meal. And Jacqueline, raise your hand, Jacqueline. Jacqueline is putting together a group of some volunteers to go help for the event. So if you want to go and serve our community, you can see Jacqueline, and she will let you know what time to be there and what to do. And you get to go serve our community and love on people, because that's what we're supposed to do, is love God and love people. Amen. That's this weekend? Okay. Huh? The Awesomeness? What the? 12 o'clock. Saturday. Yes. Did y'all hear that? They have a cupcake ride. Oh. They have cupcakes and bite ride. Let me stick to my notes. Also, there's a the church is having a Christmas party on the 13th at 6:30. I don't know anymore. I'm just ready to preach. There it is. Yeah, there you go. Right in the middle. It's on the screen. But it's gonna be a fun time too. We're asking people to bring your favorite finger foods. So let Brandy know if you're gonna what you're bringing, so that we can make sure we have enough and all that good stuff. It's gonna be a really good time if you want to come out and just goof off with us. Might even break out a karaoke machine or something. Watch some of y'all sing some Christmas carols, if we still have it. All right, I'm reading my notes, making sure I'm good. So we're on week two of our new series called Christmas Playlist. And what we're going to be doing throughout this series is I'm going to be playing a different popular Christmas song each week, and then we're going to be diving into how that applies to us and our walk. And in week one, we talked about, or we had the song play, It's the Most Wonderful Time of the Year. And then we talked about some adversity in life and how sometimes it don't feel like the most wonderful time of the year. But we know with Jesus as the focus, we can truly make any time of the year wonderful. Amen. So here's my message thought for you this morning before we show this week's song. Jesus' birth, life, death, and resurrection ushered in an everlasting kingdom for all who believe. Check out this song this week.
Oh, there's no place like home for the holidays.
I love this song.
'Cause no matter how far away you roam.
Oh, y'all can sing this Christmas caroling this morning.
When you pine for the sunshine of a friendly gaze. For the holidays, you can't beat home, sweet home.
This week gets jiggy.
I met a man who lives in Tennessee.
Come on. Oh, they killed it. They killed it on y'all. No. Cody, when Cody preached a couple weeks ago, he said, you heard me singing? I said, yeah, we almost killed your mic. No, I'm just kidding. He's on vacation this morning, so I can talk about it. Today, I want to explore what home means for us. There's the external idea of home, a place, a building, a room, a place where you spend your time. But then there's also an eternal sense of home, a feeling, an experience that is beyond the physicality of life. It's a place of belonging. And the two are completely linked. The home that we make our homes, the houses that we build, the places that we pay mortgage on, the places that we pay the utility bills on. These things are great and they're our home, but without us being there, they're just a resource consuming. But yet they still make up our home. And home isn't just what surrounds us, it's what's within us. Just like that physical building, it's more than just about what we surround ourselves in, but it's about what we allow in that makes up the home. Jesus' birth, life, death, and resurrection were the fulfillment of the prophecy that is going to be spoken by an angel called Gabriel. And Jesus made a way home to be a little bit more than just a nation or a country or a temporary temple. But Jesus offers up a new way to make home in each and every one of us by coming and establishing an eternal kingdom that's going to last forever. But yet we still get to experience it now through the Holy Spirit. Because God's kingdom is here now. Amen. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. That's more than just the prayer that we say to say a prayer. It's a prayer that Jesus gives us the reminder of how we're supposed to be living our daily lives every single day. So in Luke chapter 1, verse 26, Mary is visited by that angel, Gabriel. Now let's dive in and take a look at this story. Verse 26. In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a village in Galilee. Stop right there. It's going to be one of those messages, by the way. Sent Gabriel to Nazareth. I want to put that in perspective today. I started even looking at our little hometown, and I started thinking, all right, let's look at us. We got St. Mary Parish. I know we have some St. Martin Parish people here, too, and all. You know, we have different parishes, but we're just going to hang out in St. Mary today. And the reason why Luke puts this into his passage to point out Nazareth is because the Galilee region is so close to Samaria that people that would not have been from Israel reading this might have messed up and thought, because of the area that Jesus was from, that he was actually from outside of Israel. Because Nazareth was so small, it had been like us saying, yeah, he came from Calumet. Don't nobody say, I'm from Calumet. What do you do? I'm from Patterson. Or I'm from Centerville. Like, you know, not many. Or Verdonville, maybe. You know, Verdonville, we stretch it a little bit, but we got some population up in Verdonville. But if you're from Calumet, you're not really going to be like, where are you from, Calumet? You know what I mean? And Nazareth was so small, it's equivalent to that. And here Jesus is coming from a place that they had to kind of give a geographical area just so they can understand where he's coming from. Because for the person reading this, especially in those days, would have been like, Nazareth, I know where Galilee's at. Be like, I know where St. Mary Parish is. It's kind of like when I describe our area to people when I'm out of town. I'm like, they're like, where are you from? And I'm like, Morgan City. Where's Morgan City? A little outside New Orleans. Huh? I'm like, swamp people. Oh! I'm like, then they get it, right? I'm like, yay. They're like, y'all all talk like that? I'm like, I'm talking to you right now. But that would have been the narrative of the story. So keep that in mind as we continue to read from Mary's perspective. She comes from a very small blip on the map. Very insignificant place. Not really a big deal. Verse 27. Gabriel, the angel, the Lord sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, to a village in Galilee, to a virgin named Mary. She was engaged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of King David. We talked all about Joseph last week. Verse 28 says, Gabriel appeared to her and said, "Greetings, favored woman." And all the ladies say, "Amen." Let me do that again. Amen. Come on, y'all. Y'all ain't helping me out this morning? Yeah, y'all are. Well, there you are. Greetings, favorite woman. The Lord is with you. Or as other translations would say, blessed among women. Mary, how you doing? Little girl from Nazareth. Verse 29 is interesting, though. Confused and disturbed. Mary tried to think what the angel could mean. Y'all, he ain't even tell her she's about to have a kid. She just said, "Hey, favorite girl, how you doing from Nazareth?" She's like, "What? What you? Who? Oh, God sent you to the wrong address today. Favored? I'm married. Nobody even knows I exist except for my husband. And that was arranged." Think about how she might have felt. And she's like, "Wait, me favored? Do you know who I am? Do you see where I'm at? Like, me favored?" And I wonder how many times in our lives we've felt like Mary. We've been in some places in our lives where we're like, "Me favored? God wants to bless me? Who am I for God to do anything for me? I'm just a normal, I don't even do much in life. Like, I exist, kind of. I kind of just wake up and go to bed. Like, I go to work and some people don't even know my name. Like, that's literally me. I've been working for the same company for 19 years. And there are people there that you'll hear Mark Gowan come across an email or something, and they had no clue who I am because I stay in my little world. I'm like in my office. I'm happy in there. It's cozy and content. Right? And so I can understand that sometimes of, man, how can you see me as something special when people don't even know who I am? And sometimes in life, that's how we feel. God has looked at you and called you favored. God has looked at you and called you blessed. But if you have been looking at yourself in the wrong mirror, you have forgotten that you are created in the image and likeness of Him. And you really are favored. But yet she's still confused and even a little disturbed. And so I started asking myself, well, why would Mary be disturbed? Because if I was hanging out at my house this afternoon, minding my own business, watching the Saints beat the 49ers. And all of a sudden, an angel pops up in my house. Something about, "What's up, Mark?" "Man, God came to tell me to tell you that you favored." What? First of all, how you got in? Door never opened. Just saying. Slightly disturbed about this situation. Do you see this? Nope, just me. This is weird. How many of y'all would be disturbed? Right? You wouldn't be like, "Yes, hi, Gabriel, nice to meet you." You'd be like, "Whoa, back off, Gabriel. It's weird." And so when I see Mary's response, it makes me feel comfortable to know that that's sometimes my response to God's calling. You picked me? That's confusing. And I'm really uncomfortable about this situation. So I'm a little disturbed about it. And God often comes in and calls us to things that will confuse you and make you disturbed because it's not comfortable. And Mary is confused and disturbed because she's not comfortable. And so I got an instrument this morning. Am I going to play it? It's possible. But I started thinking about how God creates us. And I had this flute that I'm going to do my best to put together. I think I know what I'm doing. Hold on. I think that goes like that. It's got a lot of parts to this thing. Luckily, we have an instrument repair guy in the church who's going to fix it if I break it. Thanks in advance. But when you look at this thing, it's got a lot of buttons on it. Now, I was in band. I'm not proud of it. I am a band nerd. And proud of it. I play 6 instruments. This was not one of them. But, because when I look at this, I played the instruments that had 3 fingers. Because I could see 3 fingers and that computed in my head. I looked at this and I'm like, that's a lot of buttons. Looks like a keyboard almost. And so when I see me and I see an angel coming into my room and saying, Mark, you're favored. I see myself kind of like this flute. That it has a purpose, but there's a lot of complexity to it. And without knowing what to do with it, it's hard for me to accept that it's favored and that it can make something beautiful. Because I just see it as something complicated. And sometimes in our lives, we see our lives as something complicated. And I look at the life that I'm supposed to live, and I look at what God is supposed to be doing in my life, and I look at myself kind of like this flute, and I say, well, what am I supposed to do with it? As I'm looking at this flute right now, I'm not even positive how to put it together properly. I know that it's supposed to line up a certain way, correct, my dear? My daughter knows how to play this thing. I don't. And it's supposed to line up in a certain way. It's supposed to be put together a certain way. I know that you move this back and forth to tune it. I know that much. You don't move this? You don't move this part in and out? Yeah, this part. What? That's in and out. It's the same thing. Whatever. But I look at this and I ask myself, if God has called me favored and I'm supposed to be doing something for him and I don't know what it is I'm supposed to do, how do I go into action? And so a lot of times, I'm not even going to try. That's the best I can do. Thank you. That's the best I can do with what God gave me on my own. Please don't fall. All right. Let's keep looking at this story together. So we see Gabriel comes in and he's about to put her at ease. So she's confused and he's like, verse 30, don't be afraid, Mary. The angel told her, for you have found favor with God, and you will conceive and give birth to a son, and you will name him Jesus. And Mary's like, okay. The favor part got her messed up. The Jesus part, she's like, huh, how? Favor, I don't understand. Kid, how? What? Am I the only person that like reads the story this way? All right, because look what it says in verse 32. He will be great, and he will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his ancestor David, and all will reign over Israel forever. His kingdom will never end. Come on, somebody. Mary asked the angel, but how can this happen? I'm a virgin. The angel replied, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the baby will be holy, and he will be called the Son of God. Now I'm going to ask my baby to come up here real quick. Because she knows what to do with this thing, and I do not. So make sure, did I put it together right? No, I figure that. Notice how she's got to fine-tune it, right? She's like, she tried to make me, she was like, I'm just going to put it together before. I'm like, no. All right, just give me like just a single note. No, I don't want a scale, just a note. Stop. When God, Spirit, moves in and takes residence, it is the breath of God coming inside of us and then giving us breath. And sometimes we have an instrument like this and we want to start playing scales when God's just saying, make a noise. You don't have to start playing Mozart to be effective. You just got to play a note. Give me one more note. Just a note. Keep going for a second. Watch. That's the sound that heaven is trying to make out of you. You can put it down because I'm going to break it. Mary's like, I don't know how you're going to do this, God. God says, don't worry about it. The Holy Spirit's going to take care of it. And you are in here today thinking to yourself, I don't know how I'm supposed to do what God's called me to do. I want you to know the Holy Spirit's going to take care of it. The Holy Spirit will breathe into you. Now listen what happens when Mary becomes the instrument that God wants to use. We have a son who's going to be like no other son. And he's going to usher in an everlasting kingdom that has been being promised for ages. Jesus is going to be the long-expected Messiah. And since God will give him the throne of his father David, which we see in 2 Samuel and in the Psalms, he's going to have a divine sonship that qualifies him for a messianic role. Sometimes when we're in the Christmas time, in the Christmas spirit, we lose track of the reasoning behind everything. And last week we talked about how life is tough and life is a struggle and it doesn't always seem like the most wonderful time of the year. And then I told you how if we just put Jesus back in the center, he changes everything. And when Jesus comes back in this situation, he's coming back to set up something that's never been done on earth before, and we take advantage of it every single day, and we never even realize it. And that is that we have had the greatest homecoming that the world has ever gotten to see. Because just like the Holy Spirit rested on Mary, when Jesus came and lived on earth, he allowed the Holy Spirit to come and live forever with you and me. And the ultimate homecoming started in that moment. Jesus showing up sets up an eternal kingdom that me and you get to enjoy today. This is why I try to encourage all of us so much not to allow this place, this world, this ideal, this issues that we see around us, the things that we want to consume to make us think that we'll be happy. I don't want us to get stuck in this world's view of how we should do life, but instead I want us to realize that a kingdom has been established that is here today because Mary was able to be an instrument to make a sound for God, and then that sound has allowed each and all of us to make the same sound ever since. For the first time, a true homecoming of God is on the earth. Since the garden, God came every single day. When they got kicked out, he showed up in very small segments of time. And Jesus has a homecoming. He says, I'll be home for Christmas. And I want to know for us, have we been having a place for him to dwell that's a good home? See, Jesus came to reign in our hearts. And for anyone who's just willing to believe, we as believers have a great hope through Jesus that one day we get to truly experience the fullness of his kingdom. See, presently we live in this state. This is what I like to call already but not yet. Y'all might want to say that to your neighbors. Say, already but not yet. That way you don't forget it. Presently, that's where we live. In an already but not yet state. What do I mean by that? The day that you accepted Jesus as Lord, the day you decided to be a Christ follower, you have gotten to enjoy an all-readiness of atonement. Your sins were washed away. You were adopted as one of his kids. And now you get to dwell with the Holy Spirit. That's the all-readiness. The not yet part is this. 1 John 3:2. Dear friends, we are already God's children, but he has not shown us what we will be like when Christ appears. But we do know that we will be like him, for we will see him as he really is. We are already in his presence, but not all the way. And I'll ask myself this question. Am I in an all-readiness where he's with me constantly? Or am I in an all-readiness that looks more like the Old Testament, where God just kind of comes and goes as I allow him to? Think about that for a second. It's a good little thought for you. How has your readiness been? How's it been at work? You're quiet. Y'all with me? How's it been in the home when you told your kids to pick up 16 times and they still ain't done it yet? How's your readiness been? Have you maybe been like Mary? You was a little bit confused that God keeps putting you in places where you feel like no one sees you, but yet you still have a call to do something? And you're like, but God, that's disturbing. That's not comfortable. I don't want to be pushed that direction. And God said, yeah, but I'm just trying to make a noise come out of you. See, we're in this already but not yet phase. But I want us to get to an all the time and can't wait phase. Oh, that's good. I'm going to amen myself. Come on, preacher, preach. Amen. I want to get us out of an already but not yet to a all the time can't wait. In other words, I want to be ready for the embrace of Father all the time. His Holy Spirit walking with me all the time. We like to say, God is good all the time. And all the time. But yet, do we walk like it? Do we live like it? Are we an all-the-time Christian? Or are we already got what we need Christian, and then we're just waiting for the tomorrow? I don't want to be in an already but not yet state. I want to be in an all-the-time can't wait state. The church is a fellowship of persons who are both new creations, new creatures in Christ, and also some imperfect sinners. Amen. I'm going to remind us of that one more time because I didn't get enough response. So the church is a fellowship of persons who are both new creations and still imperfect sinners. Amen. And when I hear that song, there's no place like home. For the holidays, it reminds me of the sights. It reminds me of being a little boy on Thanksgiving, jumping in the car to go watch them light up the Spirit of Morgan City boat, which is so awesome now with the alligators and all the new stuff. But it's the reminders that I have of going right around Lakeside as a little boy and seeing all the houses decorated. It reminds me of being able to go hang out with all my cousins, and somehow we never really killed each other. It reminds me of good times, of happy times, of moments that have been great. But sometimes home also reminds me of difficult times. Sometimes home reminds me of a place where I've messed up. Sometimes home reminds me of a place where I haven't been who I really want to be. So how do we bridge that gap of the great memories, of the good times, but also a remembrance of where I used to be, but I'm not there anymore? You know, all around us, there's people who are not in a home today. There's people like refugees who have been forced out because of different dangers and wars or injustices in their countries. There's people who are battling with real poverty that steals a roof over someone's head. There's people who have been in a domestic abuse situation where their home feels like it's not a safe place to be. And even in the healthiest homes, there's still some imperfections. There's still some sin there, and there's still some loss there. So how do we fix it? We fix it the same way that Jesus showed up for Mary. Don't be afraid. You're favored. Don't be afraid. You're favored. I'm going to say that again until it hits home for somebody. Don't be afraid. You are favored. Even if you are confused, even if you don't understand it, even if your situation is a little disturbing, you don't have to be afraid. Jesus said that I am going to heaven so I can send someone to live with you. And it is called the Holy Spirit. And all you have to do is say, Jesus, I want to follow you, and I'm going to give you my life. And he says, from now on, the breath that comes out of you is not your own, but it's the one that I place in you, and it's called the Holy Spirit. And as the breath of the Holy Spirit enters you, you don't have to be afraid anymore. You get to realize you walk in favor. And I want you to know that you have the awesome ability to come home to the safety of Jesus every single day. Coming home for the believers is drawing us closer to Jesus. It's being in the right relationship with God and having Jesus as our joyous reunion. I want to play a little video for y'all this morning that kind of reminds us of what it is to have a joyous reunion and might pull on your heart just a little bit.
Our sons are doing what they need to do to protect the country.
People don't realize the sacrifices that you guys make. You sacrifice your friends that you grew up with, and especially getting to be home with your family.
My tour is almost over, and I'll see you, Lord,
real show.
How about if you turn around?
When is he coming home?
Hopefully a week.
She hasn't seen her son in a year and a half.
Hi, Peter.
Boys, we have a very special treat for you as well.
Staring out into the night, trying to hide the pain. I'm going to the place where and the pain you feel is a different kind of pain.
Oh my God.
What?
Turn around.
Please welcome home your son, Lieutenant Charles Draco.
Oh, Daddy. I'm coming.
Miles are getting longer, it seems. The closer I get to you.
Buddy,
I miss you.
I miss you too.
Dad.
I've watched that like for the fifth time now, and I still got tears in my eyes. But as I watch that, I'm reminded, first of all, how grateful we are to live in such an awesome country, and how thankful we are for all of our men and women who serve our country, even when you're doing it for reasons that you don't always understand. But that homecoming, that an emotional stir that we watch seeing people see their loved ones, I hope that Christmas is the same reminder that we have that Jesus came. And he wrapped his loving arms of embrace to us. And that we have a homecoming with him. And I don't know about y'all, but there's days in my life where I kind of forget. And I go about my life and it feels like I'm waiting for God to show up instead of realizing he's already home. This, the question is, have I allowed him to be here with me or not? This one, I just want to remind you that he's home. He came and established an eternal kingdom. And a small blip on the map, but the person who felt completely insignificant, but God allowed her to be an instrument used for him. And like that flute, can I tell you, if I took all those parts of that flute and threw it into a dryer this morning and let it run for millions and millions of years, it will never be a flute. You're not here by accident. You haven't been put together by accident. God created you with the purpose, and he is here to tell you he is home for you. And just like in those videos, he just wants to wrap his arms around you today and let you know that you are home. But let's say this prayer together. Jesus, thank you for coming, for giving us a reason to turn to you. You showed up to a little girl who was slightly confused and a little bit disturbed, but yet you used her. And today, I give you all my confusion. I give you my disturbedness. And God, I say thank you for making me brand new, for cleansing me of my sin and coming home in me. So today, I will walk with you because I'm home. In Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Would you stand to your feet so I can bless you? I hope this word spoke to you today. I know it did to me. You are precious to him. He is in you. He lives with you. You are his home. And he has come to make his home in you. Amen. Jesus, we're so thankful. We're so thankful. And we are so grateful today for all of you done for us. And all you've asked in return is that we worship you. So God, help us today to worship you more. Help us today to realize that you live with us. You're at home with us. That you are in our lives all the time. That it's not just something that we have to wait for. But God, you always have your arms open to us. And God, today we're going to walk out this place realizing that we are embraced by you. Even in our confusion, even when we might be a little disturbed about how things are, we know you're with us. God, I thank you for your reminder to myself today of how great you are. And God, I'm not going to be quiet about it. I will be bold and I will tell people how awesome you are. Because through my boldness, you are shown throughout the world. And Father, I thank you that you're giving us boldness today. You're blessing us. Signs and wonders follow us everywhere as we go. Not for our gain, but for your glory. And Lord, we thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen.